Bless the Lord who forgives all our sins.
Mercy endures forever.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Wash me thoroughly from my wickedness and cleanse me from my sin. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, whose glory it is always to have mercy, be gracious to all who have gone astray from your ways, and bring them again with penitent hearts and steadfast faith to embrace and hold fast the unchangeable truth of your word, Jesus Christ, your Son, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns one God forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen. Please be seated.
The Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless. And I will make my covenant between me and you, and will make you exceedingly numerous. Then Abram fell on his face, and God said to him, As for me, this is my covenant with you. You shall be the ancestor of a multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be Abram, but your name shall be Abraham, for I have made you the ancestor of a multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nations of you, and kings shall come from you. I will establish my covenant between me and you, and your offspring after you, throughout their generations. For an everlasting covenant to be God to you and to your offspring after you. God said to Abraham, As for Sarah, your wife, you shall not call her Sarah, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall give rise to nations, kings of people. Shall come from her. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The sequence is found on page 14.
Thank you.
May the Lord be on your lips and your heart, proclaiming the gospel of God at peace in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory to you, O Christ.
Jesus began to teach his disciples that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. In my many years at St. James Holy Apostles, there have been many damn road sermons, and you're going to get another damn road sermon sort of today. So be prepared, but it's not bad. Today we hear about discipleship. We hear about following Christ, taking up the cross. In about the year 405, there was Archbishop of Arles, his name was Caesareus. And in a sermon on today's text, he says some words that have sort of, I think, pulled together a little bit for us. A little long, so listen carefully, but he says, "When the Lord tells us in the gospel that anyone who wants to be his follower must renounce himself, the injunction seems harsh. We think he is imposing a burden on us. But an order is no burden when it is given by one who helps in carrying it out. To what place are we to follow Christ, if not where he has already gone? We know that Christ is risen and ascended into heaven. There, then, we must follow him. There is no cause for despair. By ourselves, we can do nothing. But we have Christ's promise. One who claims to abide in Christ ought to walk as Christ walked. Would you follow Christ? Then be humble as he was humble. Do not scorn his lowliness if you want to reach his exaltation. Human sin made the road rough. Christ's resurrection leveled it. By passing over it himself, he has transformed the narrowest of tracks into a royal highway. 2 feet are needed to run along this highway. They are humility and charity. Everyone wants to get to the top. Well, the first step is to take on humility. Why take strides that are too big for you? Do you want to fall instead of going up? Be begin with the first step, humility, and you will already be climbing. Take on humility and you will already climb. I think the heart of the passage is really, human sin made the road rough. Christ's resurrection leveled it. By passing over it himself, he transformed the narrowest of tracks into a royal highway. When we're asked to take up the cross, we are not asked to be trailblazers, but to be followers. When Alec was younger, of course, we would work occasionally on the dam road to keep it open, which I'm not really looking forward to this year because nobody was there to take care of it last year, so it means 2 years' work instead of one, but it will get done. But when Alec was younger, he also liked to, on occasion, just go exploring the woods with Dad. And that meant going where there was no trail, right? Going where there was no trail. On some occasions, you run across where they had done some logging and find raspberries that were there for a year or two until they were overgrown again. But finding a new trail, making a new trail, that's a trailblazer. When you're a trailblazer, you're busy looking ahead. It's like, where's the mud? Where's the rocky place? Where is it too thorny? You're going to get stuck in the briars. Which is the best way for us to go? Not for yourself only, but for those who would be following you. Your eye keeps looking back to make sure that the one that's following you is still there. They haven't fallen into mud. They haven't got caught in the thistles or the grass. They're not lost. They can still see you. Christ is the trailblazer. He walked the path for us. And he asks us not to be the burden bearer of making a new path, but to following the path that Christ has already brought, knowing that he's leading us and he's helping in carrying the burden. He has set the trail and we are walking with him on it, not alone, to be a follower. And we are reminded that our own human sinfulness has made the path perhaps a little rougher than it needs to be. We've made some wrong choices along the way that have maybe misdirected the path. But Christ, by walking it, has made it level. Christ, by walking it, has made that narrow path. And you see a fresher path that a person has only used once or twice because it's just like breaks in the branches. But Christ has made that narrow, once-used path into a highway for us, so that it's easier for us to walk, easier for us to follow, because we do it not alone, and we do it in a road that has been prepared. So, we're asked not to set a new path, but to take the damn road that's already been set. Deacon Trisha was saying last night, it's sort of like when you're driving on the road, this time of year in particular, you're following on the road. It doesn't mean there aren't going to be any potholes along the way. It doesn't mean there aren't going to be broken branches across the path or felled trees that we have to pass, but the path is still there. Christ has walked it, and Christ still walks it as he walks it with us. We give thanks that Christ walks with us in the travel of our journey on the road that leads to eternal life. Let us pray that we may be faithful and not distracted as we walk along the path. Follow the one, the hem of whose garment we can see in front of us as it walks along. Let us not get lost. Let us
to stay on the wide road and not head into the bramble. Let us pray that we may follow Christ faithfully. May follow Christ faithfully in the way that he's gone, the way that leads to life, even though there were potholes along the way and trees fell across our path. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. The Nicene Creed is found on page 4. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Lord, for courage to give up other things and to give ourselves to him this Lent, saying, Lord, meet us in the silence.
Give us strength and hear our prayer.
Give your church the courage to give up her preoccupation with herself and to give more time to your mission in the world.
We pray for Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our primate, William, our diocesan bishop, and for Joe Morris, our retired bishop, for our companion diocese, for the province of Jerusalem in the Middle East, and for the clergy and people on the diocese of the Anglican Cycle of Prayer this week. In our diocese, we pray for Trinity Cathedral, for St. David's Church, Cranberry, for the ministry of church sextons, the communication staff, and college chaplains, and for the Diocese of New Jersey's clergy and lay deputies as they gather virtually for the 237th Diocesan Convention this coming Saturday.
May the blood and water flowing from the side of Jesus bring forgiveness to your people and help us to face the cost of proclaiming salvation. Lord, meet us in the silence.
Give us strength and hear our prayer.
Give your world the courage to give up war, bitterness, and hatred, and to seek peace.
We pray for our nation, for Joseph, our president, Kamala, our vice president, members of Congress and the judiciary, for Philip, our governor, for all governors and all elected officials, for the leaders of all nations and those working for peace and nuclear disarmament, for the safety and well-being of all men and women serving in the armed forces and for their loved ones, and for all victims of trafficking and violence, especially gun violence, and those facing immigration, unemployment, underemployment, and furlough issues.
May the shoulders of the risen Jesus, once scourged by soldiers, bear the burden of political and military conflict in our world. Lord, meet us in the silence.
Give us strength and hear our prayer.
Give us the courage to give up quarrels, strife, and jealousy in our families, neighborhoods, and communities.
We pray for all medical workers, first responders, scientists, medical researchers, those working in vaccine production and rollout, and for all other essential workers. For those displaced and affected in all disasters, especially especially those in the southern part of our nation, and for all those working to meet their needs, for an awareness of environmental stewardship, and for the outreach ministries of this parish, especially those we serve at this time through Gleanings, the Allentown Food Pantry, the Poor Box Ministry, and the Ingathering of Socks.
May the presence of the risen Jesus, his body once broken and now made whole, bring peace and direction as we live with one another. Lord, meet us in the silence.
Give us strength and hear our prayer.
Give us the courage to give up our selfishness as we live for others, and to give time, care, and comfort to the sick.
We pray for those who are ill in body, mind, or spirit, especially Joyce and Elmer, Robert, Paul, Debbie, Melanie, Michael, Edith and Ed, Bev, George, Margaret, Angel, Bud, David, Charles, Stephen, Christine, Joey, Megan, Cynthia, Bridget, Linda, and for the health and well-being of all those in our country and worldwide who are ill with COVID-19. We pray for holy death and peace at the last for Drew, for those on the hearts and minds of our Gleanings guests, for those who live with prolonged illnesses, those preparing for and recovering from surgery, those who are with child, and all those who mourn and grieve.
May the wounded hands of Jesus bring his healing touch, and the light of his presence fill their rooms. Lord, meet us in the silence.
Give us strength and hear our prayer.
Give us the courage to give up our fear of death and to rejoice with those who have died in faith.
Especially we hold Edward Farmer, Audrey Moore, Richard J. Kirk, Sr., Priest. We pray for Frederick T. Pete and Joseph D. Pownell, for whom the sanctuary candle burns this week. We pray for Norma and Albert Zara, Sr., and Brett Zara, for whom the shrine candles burn. And through the Book of Remembrance, your prayers are requested for Sylvia Beesbury.
May the feet of the risen Lord Jesus, once nailed to the cross, walk alongside the dying and bereaved in their agony, and walk with us and all your church through death to the gate of glory.
We also pray for those celebrating birthdays this week: Jamie Rose Simpson, James Simpson, John Wagner, Danny Blair, Abigail Baker, Melissa Parch, Mary Quinn, and Judith Kerrigan. And we give thanks for the birth of Anna Reagan Pownell, daughter of Joe and great-granddaughter of Betty.
Lord, meet us in the silence.
Give us strength and hear our prayer,
here and in eternity. Amen.
Confession is found on page 7. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. By what we have done, and by what we have left undone, we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and humbled and repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Please be seated for some announcements. Because a Zoom invitation failed last week, the J2A class is being held this morning. So I'll be going directly from here into do their pre-confirmation class today. So that's happening. Tuesday night we'll be serving Gleanings as we have been. Wednesday is the regular Wednesday morning Eucharist. And then on Thursday, Stations of the Cross is at 7:30.
We continue to gather socks in the basket in the back, and then food for the Anthem food pantry up front. We'll continue to do that. Each Tuesday, they will take what socks we have gathered, and they'll distribute them, or some of them will probably come back for us to distribute later, but that's how that's working. So that is coming up. Please do note that in the past, we have had a rather large Easter egg hunt. Last year, of course, we didn't have it. We are not having an Easter egg hunt again this year. But we have an alternative plan. So, and it's there's part A and a part B to this plan. We will be preparing Easter bags. For kids, there'll be about 20 of them. First come, first serve. When they're gone, they're gone. But so we will be gathering candy, but it has to be wrapped candy. So like no jelly beans, because then they're not wrapped. So only wrapped candy, and we'll bring it in and we'll put it in the bags. So that is the first one, and we'll give those out on Easter Day to whatever kids are here. And if there aren't 20 kids here, then we'll take some home. But that is the plan for part A of the Easter bag basket program. Part B is for those that are either shut in or are unable to come because of COVID-19 that we're seeing at home, so that they know that they are not forgotten this Easter season, that we're thinking of them. So we will be gathering, there'll be some candy in it, but there'll be other items for adults. We have a list of about 16 people that we'll be preparing bags for. So if you are interested in helping with preparing the bags for the adults, speak to Lynn, because she's gonna be doing some of the coordinating on that program. So. And then we will take those bags when we do Easter communions to them, so that they will get distributed that way. We are continuing to read the Lenten book. There are other Lenten materials out on the table. Please take them and use them. If they're from my library, just return them when you're finished. Other announcements? Statements. If you didn't get your statements are here. If you don't find your statement, it means we mailed it, either by intentionally or by accident. We mailed it. So I'll report in the coming days.
Unfortunately, I also have to leave pretty soon after the service ends for a family commitment. So it'll be clergyless for a while. Have fun.
Thank you.
Please attention him and stand on page 15. Prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that fervent in prayer and in works of mercy, and renewed by your word and sacraments, they may come to the fullness of grace which you have prepared for those who love you. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took a cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, and the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him. In the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is with Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the peace.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world, the gift of God for the people of God. The body of Christ keep you in everlasting life. Please rise the first communion hymn and stand on page 16 to the following. eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as the remembrance of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now to the Lord of peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of our heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Keep this your family, O Lord, with your never-failing mercy, that relying solely on the help of your heavenly grace, they may be upheld by your divine protection. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ.
Thanks be to God.